Maybe Tyler should have its own day. That's
your Water
day.
Velvet.
Yeah.
I don't know. Velvet is all screaming.
Go for it.
All right. When we got signed to Interscope, I didn't believe it. And then I saw the advance and I didn't believe that, but then I put it in the bank. That I believed. So I thought, well, we're gonna go do this record, spend all the time, make the record that I really wanna make, and then the label is obligated contractually to put us on at least a couple of tours. And then after maybe three tours, they'll realize what a bunch of idiots they were and I'll get dropped and I'll go back to my job at the record store. And I already made arrangements with my boss. I'll be back in a year, year and a half. We had talked to a bunch of producers, but it came down to this record called Budspawn by a band called Wool, which to me sounded the most like Back in Black of any record that I'd heard. Like, had this clean, crunchy, simple delivery. And so that's why we settled on the producers of that record, Tom Rothrock and Rob Schnapft. Tom and Rob knew of this place called Philo's Ranch. It was up in the hills of Mendocino.
It looked like Jurassic Park, basically, the drive up there. And then you come out of the woods, kind of, and there's this big, long, ranch-style home, like, on the side of this mountain. I said, we're here. This is the studio, and it's just the most amazing setting. Just couldn't be more gorgeous.
Look at me. I'm in the panorama. I'm in nature. It's natural.
Beautiful valley with horses roaming around and deer and just a beautiful studio.
And your new house.
The songs that we recorded for the album were basically what we were playing live then. Like, we'd been playing them live for a couple of years at least.
It was basically a snapshot of what I thought was the best material from those years.
Okay, wanna do it?
Yeah, let's try it.
Well, we had a piece of music worked up, and I didn't feel like it needed words, so I wanted to leave it instrumental. As a nod to the Reverend Horton Heat, I wanted to put it on the record first. I think it was full custom that starts off with instrumental. Yeah, I remember having a conversation with our rep at the label. He said, I'm concerned that people will get this record, take it home, and listen to it, and hear no words on the first song and think that there's something wrong with it and take it back and return it and get their money back.
The label, they were not totally receptive to that, you know. You don't want to open your album with an instrumental. It's like, well, actually, yes, we do. I don't think anybody could imagine that album without Mexican Hairless being first.
Policewoman style.
Got it.
Miss.
Mr. Love. Well, there was another band in town that I just got a big kick out of because they all changed their names. And one of the guys in the band changed his last name to Love. And I just thought that was hilarious. I modeled those lyrics around basically that guy saving me and the whole Dallas-Fort Worth music scene. And that was back in, 1990, I guess.
We're the Toadies, and this is where we rehearse. I'm Todd, this is Tracy. This is Charles. This is Lisa. That's Mark. Here we are.
The band started off when I was working at a record store over on the west side of Fort Worth. I had been in a cover band up to that point, but tired of playing covers. I wanted to play original music. I'd heard some Sex Pistols and some Pixies and some Talking Heads, and I really wanted to do something along those lines. And so I got a hold of a couple of people that worked at the record store. Lisa was interested in learning how to play the bass, and this guy, Charles, knew how to play guitar and was interested in learning how to play leads.
Todd taught me everything I know, so if I... his
we went through a period where I was just singing and I wasn't playing guitar, so we had another guitar player. Then we just had a transition through a couple other members and wound up with the four of us that are on the record.
It's cool.
Come on back.
You see this, Todd?
What?
His oars, man. Hanging over the rails. Like, hey, man, what's up?
What's going on?
My beer.
With this record, I wasn't comfortable enough expressing myself to be direct about what I was feeling. And as a listener, I really don't want to hear somebody tell me exactly what they're feeling, because I would rather have them just tell me a story and let me have a feeling from it. So that's what I try to do. My grandparents lived in East Texas, where my dad grew up on a farm, and we would go visit them for holidays. Inevitably, around the table, they would start talking about what's going on, of course, in the family. And one of the conversations turned to some guy who had been spotted running around these farmhouses in East Texas and peeking in windows. Now, he's probably going to break into a house sooner or later and nab somebody or do something terrible. And I look over at the window. Yeah, that's just right there. That'd be creepy if a guy peeked in the window. Then I look over the other way, and there's a rifle rack with 8 shotguns on it, you know, and 30-06, all kinds of crazy guns all over the place. I'm thinking, every one of these houses is armed to the teeth. I mean, these people stay alive, they hunt, and they protect their property. And instantly I just went, there's no way this guy's for real. Then years later, I was thinking back on that and thinking, well, I think that was just some hysteria going on. But what if the guy was real? And what would he be thinking, and what would he do? So that's what I wrote Tyler about. This guy, his thought process about being in love with somebody, so in love that he would go risk life and limb to just be with this person.
Find a window in the kitchen where I let myself in. I rummage through the refrigerator, find myself a beer. I can't believe I'm really here, and she's lying in that bed. I can almost feel her touch and her anxious breath. I stumble in the hallway, outside her bedroom door. I hear her call out to me, I hear the fear in her voice. She pulls the covers tighter, I press against the door. I will be with her tonight, yeah. I will be with her tonight. I will be with her tonight, yeah. I will be with her tonight. I will be with her, yeah, yeah.
This is stupid, but there's a moment sometimes when you're writing where you're like, I don't have any idea what this line is going to be. I've got these lines before it and these after it, and I have no line to go in this one spot. I'm thirsty. So he's going to get a beer now. That's what he's going to do.
I will be with her. Yeah.
Tom preparing tonight's dinner. And I'm heading out the front door here. Really awesome view.
Away. I was working at the record store. I had some lyrics about just escapism and just wanting just another transcendent type idea of just where you can mentally just change where you're at to somewhere else, to find peace or happiness or calmness or whatever you need to find. So I was kind of mulling around these ideas, and I couldn't ever come down on anything firm about how to bring it together in a song. And just coincidentally, I'm talking to my boss, Charles, at the record store. I can't even remember what the conversation was, but I remember him saying something about standing under a tree with the grass under your feet. And I thought, well, there it is. That's the song. That's where I wrote the idea from being under some tree that somehow shelters you and changes everything, that you can just be, now you're in the wilderness, just away from everything. There's a line, and I think people misinterpret, in my heart there's a heaven. What I was trying to get at was, I know that if there's a heaven, it's inside of me. And to try to find that peace inside of myself. And that's as close as I could get at the time with the vocabulary that I had. Song that's it's about a person that was in my life that I don't really want to get into too much detail about. It's not a big deal. It's not about a lover or anything like that. It's just about a person that removed themselves from my life abruptly. I kind of thought, well, sooner or later, you're going to see evidence of our friendship and our relationship that are going to haunt you. Backslider was it was the last one of the last songs I wrote before recording Rubberneck, and also one of the most revealing, I think, because it's about a personal experience.
Son, I am so proud. Just one word. Backslider!
That song is about being a kid and being brought up in a religious household, and just the anxiety and fear and sheer terror that that brought on. It was one of the earliest songs that I actually got into something really personal, rather than writing a fictional story or just absolute spite.
Yeah.
I Come From the Water was one of the first songs I wrote in the band. Speaking of being brought up religious, that was kind of a self-study on being brought up by a man who's extremely religious, but he still believes in evolution.
I come from the water. I crawled up on the shore. I left my brothers there. I got what I came for. I stood up on these legs and held my head up high and burned beneath the sun to start a new life. I love to see the sun in spite of all this stuff. I pray for shade and rain. I pray to live again. I come from the water. I come from the water. I come from the water. I come from the water.
Musically, I guess, I mean, looking back on it, there's a lot of Tejas era, ZZ Top, Texas music, that boogie kind of feel that I didn't really notice at the time. Happy Face is kind of just an ambiguous fuck you to glib people. I've got no real good story there. There's a lot of animosity in my life at that time. So people that smiled kind of bugged me.
Killer.
Velvet was about a definite person, a love of my life that screwed me over and left me, and, you know, that was a pretty black and white, cut and dried, I got screwed situation. Just kind of went into a full Freudian on that one.
Oh, mommy, mommy, oh.
Todd's singing was always like, it's like a force of nature almost. Just hearing this deep, guttural, primal scream coming out of this skinny kid, you know, is like, how can that sound be coming out of that guy? He went for it, because we figured this is the only chance we get. This is going to be our album.
Just to put on the headphones and be in a studio and be in this song, it just was cathartic, I guess.
Get away! Get away! You hurt me, you fuck! You hurt me, you fuck! You hurt me!
Fire is bright, fire is clean, never so smoke is freedom, flame is mercy, I am free tonight, and I burn.
This is a long story, but I burn, let's see, let me back up. I was dating a girl, and I had this dream that she had invited me to a party, so I'm going to go to this party. I'm walking down the street, and as I get closer to the party, there's a mailbox on fire, then there's a trash can on fire, and then eventually there's just whole houses engulfed in flames. And so I'm getting closer to the party, and I get to this house, and I kind of walk around the back where the party is, and it's all these people jumping around and dancing around. There's music, there's drums, and there's a giant bonfire, and one by one these people are throwing themselves into the fire. Idea is that they were going to transcend their physical bodies by immolation. So they were going to burn themselves in order to become something higher power, something bigger outside the physical realm. And that's what I Burn is about. That's taking the voice of somebody who is in that cult or whatever you want to call it. as I want to do a lot of times, I make up character and carry it through several songs. So then I finished out I Burn, and I thought, well, suppose this guy does it, and he's just screwed, because now he's just smoke. And where does he go from there? So he goes to Possum Kingdom and tries to find somebody to join him. In my teens, I guess my 20s, I would go out to Possum Kingdom Lake where my family has some land, and it was just really cool and creepy and just a really interesting place. Names like Hell's Gate and Devil's Island and all this weird nomenclature that just kind of lends itself to that kind of storytelling. Around the lake tonight by my side. Yeah, well, I was reading a lot of Stephen King and similar type horror fiction and every dark thing that I could read. And so that song is about a character that's kind of stuck in a netherworld out floating around Possum Kingdom Lake. And he's lonely and freaked out and is wanting to lure somebody else into his little realm. I'll show you my dark secret. This guy wants to convince somebody else to do what he did, which is to burn themselves alive in order to be this other thing. The essence of that is taking something that is beautiful and whole and destroying it in order to create something else. Do you wanna die? That's why in the video there's a creepy guy with the block of ice, and he's creating this ice sculpture which will just be beautiful for just a moment, and then it's gonna melt and just be nothing. Jesus. It's weird, it's how my brain works. Ha 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 ha.